started right now into the live stream. We're going to jump into today's topic, and we've already started talking about it a little bit in the pre-show, but today's topic is really about the idea that photography itself is not really about photography, or it's not entirely about photography. And I shared a couple quotes. I'll cover them real quick. The first one was from Bresson, Honoré Cartier-Bresson. It says, "It's looking that's important, not photography." The second quote that he shared, that I shared of his, was, "Technique is important only insofar as you must master it in order to communicate what you want or what you see." And then the last quote that I shared was from David Duchemin, who is the author of This Beautiful Anarchy that we were just talking about pre-show. But it's, "The first work of the photographer is not to use the camera, but to see." So I'll say it again because I stumbled over the words. "The first work of the photographer is not to use the camera, but to see." And I really, really enjoyed this topic. And it's something that, like I was sharing a little bit pre-show, is pre-show. I don't know what else to call this. Pre-stream. I don't know. But is really this whole topic to where, you know, so often as photographers, we could really get caught up in the art, or I guess I'd say the craft of photography, which is great. I for one, am an absolute lover of the craft of photography. But at the same time, so often I find that I almost park within the craft of photography. You know, I'm watching interviews with other photographers and watching, you know, gear reviews and what's in my bag videos and, you know, technique videos of here's new compositional techniques and all these different things. And I start trying to add all these tools to my toolbox. But there's a point to where, you know, if all a mechanic were to do was to purchase new Snap-on tools to put in their toolbox, there's almost a sense of you start to feel like a mechanic, but you're not actually a mechanic until you're working on vehicles or you're working on whatever it is that you might be working on. And we can build up our toolbox, but if we're not actually using the tools on the things that we're supposed to be working on, all we've done is really build a solid toolbox that makes us look the part, but we're never actually activating and participating within the thing. And, you know, to kind of take that analogy a step further, if all the mechanic is doing is building a toolbox, they're investing all their time, effort, energy, resources into the toolbox, and all of a sudden resources begin to deplete because they're not actually getting paid for any jobs that they're doing because they're not doing jobs, they're just building up this toolbox. And it's oftentimes the same. I know with this community specifically, I talk to a lot of you guys on a regular basis to where so many of you guys are looking to do something with your projects. It's one thing to do projects. It's another thing to do projects that will actually go out there and possibly even make a secondary stream or even a main stream of income to be able to fund more projects, to be able to invest more time into building tools and everything like that. And I love this idea of really taking a step away, not necessarily away, but really shrinking the amount of time that we're focused on actually the craft of photography and taking more time on focusing on the language and the things that we're trying to use our photography to honor, to recognize, to capture, to, you know, commemorate, and all these different ideas that we're really trying to lock into a picture form, or that we're just trying to experience in life in general. I know so many photographers who, you know, say that the camera is really just a ticket to experience life, and it's just a reason and an excuse to get out there and just explore life and experience life and to adventure through life and then get to capture it along the way, get to share it with others along the way. And I really love that aspect of really shifting over from a majority into photography into, you know, definitely focusing on our photography, definitely still honing our craft, but then moving over to the aspect of really recognizing the things that are in front of our lens, really recognizing not just the things that are in front of our lens, but the things that are in other areas and avenues of our life, right? Our other interests and passions and narratives that we're feeding off of to really give us a new language to bring over to our photography, to bring over to our work, to our projects, to everything like this. You know, I'm going to continue on a little bit and then I'll jump over to the comments here, but I love... You guys know that I'm a huge, huge Ralph Gibson fan, and I love listening to interviews about him, and he talks about how he's just been honored and blessed to be able to have run with all the great photographers of his day. You know, he knew guys like Gary Winogrand and Joel Meyerowitz and Jay Mazel, and he was running with all these guys. He was in Magnum for a while. You know, he knew Elliot Erwitt. He was just walking alongside so many of these guys, having conversations with so many of these guys. And the thing that he says to be true about every single one of these great photographers, every single one of these guys that fill up our bookshelves here, right? The people that we admire, the people that we look out to and try and find inspiration from, try and learn from. So the thing that distinguished them from all the other photographers was they were great men of accolade. They were great women of education. They were very educated. They were very cultured. They had so much more going for them than just their photography. They knew how to experience life. They knew how to approach life and how to have deep and meaningful conversations. And it's these things that actually led to them being able to do the things that they did with the camera. It wasn't them just understanding the tools and the, it is that, but it's that and. It's other 90%, as I said. And again, that 90% is really just a mythical number that I threw out there, but it's the other 90% that really plays in well to, you know, going back a few weeks to where we were talking about finding your creative vision, finding your creative voice. It's so much more than just the tools and gear and the editing style and the film choice that we make. It's so much more the other 90% of our life that we're living, that we're experiencing, that we're working through. So I'm going to jump over to the comments here. Then I'm going to go over into some of the comments from today's video that you guys left in the comments section, because there were some really, really good thoughts that started to come out. So let's see here. J-Dub says, Vincent Van Gogh said, great things are done by a series of small things brought together. I really like that. I do think that that's I think if we start to think about it in almost these like building blocks, you know, what kind of building blocks are we actually adding to our Lego pile to be able to build these things? If all we're doing is working off the yellow Legos, which is, you know, that fell apart real quick, but hopefully you guys understand what I mean. If yellow Legos are the you know, gear and the tools of photography, where are we getting our red and green and blue Legos from to build the rest of whatever it is that we need to build? Terrible analogy, but I hope you guys understood. Jacob said, another great book is The War of Art. It's a great read to help with creative ruts. Yeah, you know, I might have to read that one again. I did read The War of Art, and personally, I really grappled with a lot of things in it, which is probably a good thing. It wasn't necessarily something that really stood out to me as something that I would revisit in the future. Excuse me, but I've heard so many people reference it once again that I might have to jump back in and reread it. Pat says, do you know if Henri Cartier's book was released in French as well? I'm sure it probably was. Most of his books, I believe, are released in French. If not, it's probably coming out soon. I know that Aperture is really good at releasing in multiple different languages. So, let's see here. Gabe, what's up, buddy? Good seeing you out there. Hi everyone, how are you doing? Thanks for the video this Tuesday, Nick. It was awesome. You're welcome, buddy. Good seeing you in here. Charlie says, fantastic topic, Nick. I enjoy using and gathering tools, but getting out and using them is more enjoyable. For sure. And I think so many of us, especially within film photography, because, you know, old cameras are so easy to collect. They're so easy to go out and try and hunt for and find. And there's just, and it is fun. You know, I still do it. I still, anytime I go to a thrift store, I'm looking around to see if there's any cameras to acquire and you know, like cool things that I could come across. But at the same time, I've heard so many people say that they've realized that they became more of a camera collector than an actual photographer. And that's the trap that I want to try and avoid. And there's nothing wrong with collecting cameras. Like, if that's what you want to do, then that's awesome. But at the same time, me personally, my own, you know, personal artistic convictions is I'm trying to get out there and actually use the tools that I have. I actually want to get out there and create with the things that I've acquired. Whether it be tool in the physical material or tool within the learning and, you know, compositional and thought process type of thing. I don't want to just learn to learn. I want to learn to apply. And I don't want to just gather to gather. I want to gather to apply. And I think that's a big part of what we're talking about today. So, Not Afraid of Grain says, buying gear is exciting and all, but taking photos and living the experience is absolutely addictive. It really is. You know, and a big thing for me lately is, I've probably talked about it multiple times on the different streams, is I'm looking at this year going, like, where are the places that we want to travel? Where are the places that we want to go? And I started actually selling off some gear that I was, you know, excited to have and excited to use and did use on many occasions, but started really kind of going, well, I mean, I could either sit at home and, you know, tour the same streets over and over using this gear that's amazing, or I could use, you know, a honed down set of gear and stuff that I know that I could still create amazing images with and be able to travel, be able to get out there and experience new areas. So it's something that I've made a priority this year, is really going, okay, am I going to acquire gear this year, or am I going to try and value traveling and doing different things like that? So whether or not we'll be able to travel is a, you know, another question, but it's something that I'm totally trying to work towards, at least, and really hustle towards, to be able to get out there and be able to point my camera at new exciting adventures. So Gabe says, Charlie, we all know that you love fixing the camera more than using it. Total joke, for sure. That's funny. Charlie's really good at fixing cameras, though. Sometimes I see you bringing back some cameras to life that I'm like, man, I wouldn't know anything of what to do if I tore that thing apart. Miles, what's up, buddy? Good seeing you. He says, hey, guys, sorry I'm late. No worries, you're not really late at all. Welcome to the party. Mr. Synthetic says, is there a book you have to read, video coming out, or is there one? Yeah, books that you have to read. These are, I definitely want to, I mean, I have a giant bookcase now of photo books, and so many of them are just absolutely astonishing and are really, really adding and shaping the way that I look and search through my own work and how I interpret my own work and some of the language that I bring to my own work. And some of them aren't even photography books, you know. I love diving into books about, you know, Rothko and Mondrian and Matisse, and, you know, looking at the works of these guys. Lately, I've been going back through like the Renaissance paintings and looking at the way that they explored light, looking at the way that they explored gesture and composition, and how they would gesture people in order to complete compositions, and how they would lead the eye. I mean, they were masters within composition. They were masters within training the eye on where to go. I mean, they knew exactly where they wanted to place your eye, and then they knew exactly how to get there, and really looking through those things. So I definitely want to dive into my bookshelf and start sharing some of these things, and really kind of share some of these amazing books, and then some of the ones that I've just recently got. And there's some, like, Matt Day did a What's in His Bookshelf video the other day, and he talked about Magnum contact sheets, and I've heard a lot of people talk about this. I don't have it. I've seen it over at Jacob's house, but I haven't intensively looked through it, but I hear a lot of people say that it let them down. But then there's other books like the Magnum Stories that actually go into the stories behind a lot of the images. And then there's actually a Lustrum Press contact sheets. That's an amazing, amazing book, to where it dives into specific photographers and how they dive into their contact sheets. And I want to share some of those too. But so yes, I will be sharing some stuff like that in the future. Jacob says, Charlie is making great cameras and even better photos. That's right. Pat Garcia says, time for me to leave, sadly. Thanks for the live stream, guys. Bye. Thumbs up. See you, buddy. Sorry you have to take off so quick. Clinton says, I've been gathering so many tools to expand my knowledge in the darkroom, but this week I started to wonder why I'm not using the knowledge that I already own. And that's one of the things. Actually, I want to jump over. Clinton, I'm going to piggyback your comment with the comment that came in earlier from Jeffrey Bars, I think is how you say Bars. He had two parts to his comment, but I'm going to share the first part that he said in the comments of the video. He said, I agree with you, except that maybe with beginners like me, the ratio should be something like 70-30. So 70% about photography, 30%, or maybe he was saying 70% about life and 30% about photography. Jeffrey, if you're on here, I guess I would like a clarification as to what you meant by that, because I don't want to run off in a direction if I'm talking completely opposite from what you were saying. But experienced photographers take for granted how much they already know, not just about cameras and lighting and exposure, but also about developing and software. They weren't born with these expertise. They acquired it early on, and maybe now it feels like second nature. I think these two, Clinton, your comment, and then Jeffrey, your comment, really play off well together. I would say yes and no. And actually, Clinton, I think your comment kind of answers a little bit what Jeffrey was talking about. I still think for a lot of cases, it's still like a 90-10. You know, when people get into photography, I'm not trying to, I've been doing classes with some guys at work that I work with and teaching them photography. And what I'm not doing is I'm not sitting down and trying to shower them with all the different techniques and all the different things. I'm trying to give them something small to be able to focus on for the week, you know? And to bring into their still daily lives, to be able to recognize the things that they were recognizing in the first place that made them want to pick up photography. What I'm not trying to do is get them consumed by photography. I'm still giving them 10% and then going, use that 10% to do a little bit better job at capturing the 90% of what you're doing. So it might be aperture for the week. Hey, let's look at aperture. Let's look at the depth of field and actually understand what that actually means, and really kind of dive into that. And then next week we can talk about shutter speed. Next week we can talk about ISO, whatever it might be. But I think, you know, oftentimes the journey to understanding photography is actually elongated when we try and force feed so much stuff in right off the get-go. There's only, I mean, if we have this funnel, you can only have so much stuff go in or go actually make it through the bottom, but we start trying to pile all this stuff on the top. But if we were to just kind of work off of, okay, this week I'm going to focus on the rule of thirds, and I'm just going to focus on that, or I'm going to focus on dynamic composition, and I'm going to focus on that, or whatever it might be. I'm going to focus on color or black and white or seeing this tonality, or giving ourselves these bite-sized chunks actually gives us much better measurable results at the end of things. We could actually gauge our improvement at the end of the week, at least within those techniques, right? Again, that's just focused on techniques. That's just focused on learning the equipment. But I think if we try and, the thing that I did when I first started getting into photography was I would spend weeks upon weeks upon weeks upon weeks just watching all sorts of videos. I'd watch Digital Rev and Art of Photography and all these, you know, various different things, and then sign up for Kelby One and sign up for Creative Live. And I was just force feeding all this stuff in. And it was just this paralysis to where I started to get to a point to where I thought the way to become a better photographer was to learn more things. And actually the way to become a better photographer is to get out and photograph. And actually the only way to be a photographer is to get out and photograph. So like Clinton was saying, he'd been gathering all these tools to expand his knowledge within the darkroom. But one of the best ways, I tell people all the time when they ask me how to get into to darkroom printing. I'm not the greatest darkroom printer by any means. I actually have very, very, very basic knowledge within the darkroom. But at the same time, I'm able to at least finagle the prints to a place to where I want them just by getting in there and experimenting, you know? And then it's as I'm going. We kind of talked about it in the video to where I talked about having the 100 episodes and what it looked like to create the 100 episodes. The more I sat down to figure out how to become a YouTuber, the more that I sat down to figure out how to make YouTube videos and proper vlogs and all these different things, I started to paralyze myself. I started to get into this gear paralysis to where I was like, well, this camera does this thing, this camera does this thing. The best way that I became a YouTuber was to actually just get out there and make videos for YouTube. And as the car was rolling, we could actually turn the wheel and shift and make these zigs and zags along the way. So, Jeffrey, what I'm not saying is your comment is wrong. I just still think, at least in my thought process, and nobody has to agree with this or whatever, I still think it's 90-10. I still think it's focusing on the small parts of honing our craft while we're gathering, you know, the life in front of us. And then we go back and we hone another bit of our craft. As I started shifting over to this, I removed a lot of the paralysis from things, and that actually became more fun because I wasn't focused on 17 different things. I was focused on trying to do one thing better, and then focusing on doing one thing better led to doing that one thing better, and then I could focus on another thing better. So I want to jump back into some of the comments here and see what you guys are saying. Fedeskier says, hey from Italy. Hello. Italy, nice. Yes, very nice. Violent Buffalo AC says, you're a great help to remind me to slow down and actually think before stressing out about just shooting everything. Nice. I'm glad to hear that. That's encouraging. Jacob says, I wouldn't beat yourself up, Clinton. The dark room is very much a place where gathering more tools just happens. Sure. Kit Young, what's up, buddy? Good seeing you in here. Kit, I'd actually be very curious to hear your thoughts on this. I'm always, like, anytime I throw any of these ideas out, I kind of think about you, because sometimes we really connect on things, and then sometimes we not butt heads, but we're completely different sides of the spectrum as far as how we approach our photography, and I absolutely love that, so I'd really be curious to hear your thoughts. J-Deb says, I want to go to Ireland. Yes, I really want to go to Ireland, too. I just got a book in. It's all Magnum photography about Ireland, and it's just incredible. And actually, I have a couple other Magnum books about Ireland, and just really, I definitely want to go to Ireland at some point. And actually, I want to go visit the county of Mayo. My adopted parents, my father has heritage back there, so I'd like to go and see the heritage there. Charlie says, Jacob Murphy is right. You'll find where the tools become very helpful and useful. Totally. And it's really in the act that you start to learn where the tools, you know, it becomes all this head knowledge otherwise. But when we actually get into the act of these things, the tools actually make much more sense. Gabe says, one thing that I love to look at alongside photography is YouTube channels like Polyphonic and Nerdwriter, Every Frame, a painting where they dissect art in general. Completely. You know, I think cross-platforming, you know, Gabe sends over sometimes these videos to where guys will dissect different audio, you know, check out this song, and this is what Bob Dylan was saying in this song, and I really enjoy that. I love looking at a poem being dissected. Sometimes I watch just old raps being dissected. I watched this thing about how, you know, Eminem is one of the greatest rappers of all time, and it started dissecting the way that he would, you know, pair up words and the way that he would rhyme words and extend words in order to make them rhyme. And when you start seeing it, you automatically start pulling some of that language over into, you start seeing where the gap closes into where that language is actually much more fluent in our language as well, and where we could actually bring and pull some of those things in. So I absolutely love that. I love looking at poetry. Emily and I went to a, what's that called? Spoken word. Thank you, baby. Emily's downstairs. She's yelling up to me. We went to a spoken word workshop, and just seeing how this guy who's amazing with spoken word breaks down how he writes something and gives himself these personal challenges and all these different things are just so interesting. And I'm not great with spoken word. It wasn't like I walked away as an expert, but I walked away with a new mindset at least, and maybe a slightly different, you know, tick within the degrees that I'm able to look at something. So I really enjoy that. So Gabe, thank you for sharing that. Clinton says, very true, Jacob. Thankfully, I started working on making that space light tight. That's my only struggle right now. Hoping to start printing this weekend. Nice. That's exciting. Manoy says, to using tools idea, I was thinking about getting a Nashika 3D camera for a project in the future. I don't think that will happen. It's now $300 versus $20. Yeah. Sometimes you can get lucky and find them at a thrift store. That's really the best way to find them, because otherwise people charge a crazy amount for them. So many of those cameras. I've ranted about it in live streams in the past, but I just cannot. For a camera like that, anything with a plastic lens or, you know, point and shoot cameras, I just can't justify spending much more than $20 on them. But that's just me. Some people value those, and that's perfectly fine as well. Let's see here. when Oi says, do you have a book on Rembrandt? I do. And actually, the book that I have on Rembrandt is, to me, very fantastic. And it's actually a book that I cherish a lot. I found it at an antique store maybe 2.5, 3 years ago. But it's just Rembrandt on Christ. And it's he just went through and started... he was just fascinated with the life of Christ and the disciples and everything like that. So it's a bunch of sketches and paintings, and it's just all based around the subject matter that I'm fascinated with as well. I absolutely love Christ and just diving into that. But then seeing how he translated scripture that has been so familiar to so many people for so long, but then seeing it put into a visual act is just so unique and so interesting. So I do have that book. But then also, thinking about Rembrandt, we in photography use so much inspiration from him, whether we know it or not. We call it Rembrandt lighting, right? When you get that triangle of light and that angle of 45 degree light coming over and defining the face and giving structure to a face, giving dynamic to a face. We're very much influenced by him. J. Deb says, I went to the Mark Rothko Chapel in Houston years ago. I don't know if you can hear Emily downstairs. We really, really want to make it out to the Mark Rothko Chapel. Abstract works, Rothko is by far one of my all-time favorites. The depth of his standing in front of his pieces is just like, it's a lot of what I hope to get out of my pieces. I simplify my compositions down quite often to where I'm focused on just the details. And you look at his compositional structure for years was two squares or, three rectangles or these different, balances of color and structure and form and how simple it is, but how complex it is. There's just so much soul and weight and depth to him. I absolutely love that. So we do hope to make it down there and go to that at some point. And it'll probably be a very emotional experience when we do. So that's awesome. Mr. Synthetic says, maybe like a most important books version on YouTube and some less important books on Instagram. Yeah, it's definitely something that, you guys know I talk about photo books all the time. I truly believe there's a lot to be gained about YouTube videos, about Instagram and looking at the works, but there's just something different when you could actually hold, The Americans by Robert Frank in your hands and actually dive in deep to it and actually spend time just staring at the images. It's why I have images all over the place, of family. I got an image of my niece up here, all these images of Emily right here, and just these different images that I sit with and I live with. I got this whole thing back here that's just constantly, sharing these images. And as I walk through, there's just something about this tangible form, and books are the only thing that I know that you could really live with on that kind of instance and experience that kind of stuff. Anyways, I want to jump back over to comments that came in on the YouTube video today and just kind of highlight some of these, because I think some great, great comments came in. So Finzi said, just yesterday I watched the latest video by Thomas Heaton, and he put it quite nicely, although a bit different. He said, photography is not about the image, but about being out there and exploring. So in his definition of photography, taking an image is just a small part. He includes being out there and exploring, finding compositions, and training the eye into the photographic or photography process. So even if you're not taking images, you are still doing photography. I thought that was quite well put. I completely agree. And I do think that adds another level of this whole conversation of really, If it's not entirely about photography, then it's also maybe not entirely about the image. Although at the same time, we're in photography to create the image. But I do love that, to where photography is really the art of seeing, photographies, the art of writing with light. But I really do love that idea of it's really about learning to see whether we have a camera in hand or not. I constantly, as Emily and I are walking on, you know, through town, or as I'm walking even through the church as I'm working during the day, I'm seeing these shafts of light that are being created. And it's very much where the Sketches of Light zine came from, right? Was this idea of I can't help but to catalog these, and I can't help but to see these and recognize these. But it's a big thing of being able to learn to see all the time. It's not something we turn on and turn off when we have a camera in our hand. It's something that we learn to see as we go forward. Fee, if you're on here, good seeing you. I don't know how to say your last name. I guess I should have. I met Fee a couple times in person, but she was at the New York photo walk and everything. But Fee says, my photography has changed so much after starting to dive into other aspects of art. Currently, I'm reading in a conversation with Robert Irwin book, who is an installation artist. But the way he sees, understands, and questions are so amazing that it's tipped my view upside down. That's awesome. One of the things that I watched, if you guys are familiar with the masterclass, it's kind of like the new Creative Live or whatever, but they have like Martin Scorsese and they have people like Steve Martin, some other people. But the big one, they have Annie Leibovitz on there, which is amazing. I haven't seen it, but it looks amazing. The big one that I was looking at was the jazz musician Herbie Hancock. And just watching, I haven't even seen the actual video. I really want to get the video. But just looking at the preview of the video, it's about 3 or 4 minutes long. And just the way that he breaks down jazz is so, so interesting. The way that he sequences jazz is just like, there's so much consistent language throughout. Really breaking over. We've already talked about it a little bit, but really breaking over to other areas of interest is so important. Murphy's Film. So Garth, if you're on here, buddy, I haven't seen you in here yet. Or maybe I did. Garth says, every shot you take should be a selfie of what you see. I think that's a funny way of putting it, but I really do agree. There's so much of, we talked about it a little bit last week when I kind of touched on this topic a little bit. That if we talk about that other 90% of photography, I think even though we've been talking about getting over to the other 90% of photography, I think we're still kind of focusing on the 10% and kind of justifying it. But then moving over to the other 90% is really where the personality of the photographer comes in. It's really, you know, it is that creating a self-portrait in every single instance that we push the shutter. You know, as much as we're saying something about the thing that we see in front of the camera, we're also saying something about the eye that's seeing behind the camera. And it starts to reveal the lenses that we see the world through. It starts to reveal our world views and these point of views that we start to see things through. We start to see, you know, whether we're pessimistic or optimistic, or, you know, what it is that's inside of us begins to come outside of us, just because it's still the very thing that determines the bias on how we see the things that we see and how we determine the things that we see, even the things that we're gravitating towards. You know, we gravitate towards things like, you know, whether it be Bresson or Robert Capa or anything like this, there's a reason on why we gravitate towards that work, and really exploring that is also a very, very powerful thing. You know, when I want to talk about in future episodes, to where I want to kind of talk about what it looks like to actually dissect a book or dissect a project. And it's something that I'm growing on myself, and I'm really challenging myself quite a bit on, is when I go to Robert Frank's The Americans, am I just looking at it for compositional secrets or for subject matter? Am I actually going in and going, why is it that I like this image or that I don't like this image? And what is it that when I respond to an image, why is that? What is inside of me that's making me respond to the image in this way? And we kind of talked about it a little bit in the past, but really diving in a little bit further to really dissect compositions, dissect, you know, works and artists that we really admire, really understanding at least a little bit more as to why it is, will give us at least a little bit more insight as to what our creative vision might be, as to what our creative voice might be in the long run. Because I think we recognize in others, the things that we recognize that we enjoy in others are actually things that we recognize and enjoy in ourselves. We're constantly searching for bits and pieces of ourselves in others. And this is why so many people are so frustrated when people aren't like them. Because we just sometimes, we've been at the center of our life for so long, we don't know how to approach anything other than ourselves. Which is not necessarily the best thing, but at the same time, if we take that understanding and if we apply that to the things that we gravitate towards, to the things that we find visually appealing and the things that speak to our soul and speak to just our emotional responses, when we actually understand that we're actually finding some bit of ourself in there, it no longer becomes imitation, it becomes discovery. I've talked about it a little bit in the past, but I want to make an entire video about this because I get so many people who bring up the idea of being inspired by Ralph Gibson. And it's one of these things to where, yes, I'm inspired by Ralph Gibson. I'm not going to deny that. But the truth is there was actually a bit of Ralph Gibson. There's so much of Kit Young, you know, so much of any of these guys that I admire, where I'm actually recognizing something of myself in them, right? Where I'm actually, you know, finding permission and finding affirmation in the things that they're shooting, because it's things that I gravitate towards as well. I might not shoot them the exact same way that they do, but I find them visually appealing. And they might inform my work in the future, but it's informing based off of a fact that I've discovered a little bit more of, you know, my visual aesthetic. And I don't think that that's a bad thing. I think we've made imitation a bad thing, but really imitation, we're imitating the things that we've found in ourselves in the first place. I think it's really just discovery in a lot of different ways. And then there's sometimes towards bad imitation, right? You're just running forward trying to recreate what other people did, and that's not what I'm talking about at all. But anyways, that's kind of a very long tangent, but something that I wanted to just put out there and see what you guys have to say. I'm going to cover a couple more of these topics from today's comments in the YouTube channel, and then I'll jump back over here to some of you guys' comments over here. Wayward Ace says, photography is not just the act of taking the photo. It's about the lead up, the preparation, the journey, the fun, and the enjoyment of all of it. The photo is just the end result. That was from Kai Wong over on, used to be over on Digital Rev, but now is on Kai Wong YouTube from 2016. I absolutely love that. Really do agree a lot on that. You know, it's, they say oftentimes it's not the destination, it's the journey. And I'd definitely say, you know, we need to learn to appreciate and embrace the journey. Mark says, just checking in briefly, got a few minutes before I have to drive somewhere. Thanks for Gray Ghost. Hey, you're welcome, buddy. You probably jumped off by now because I had a very, very long tangent, but it's good seeing you on here, and I'm happy that you won that. Gabe says, time to go meet with the boss man. Hopefully I'll be able to come back later. Highly suggest checking out those YouTube videos for sure. Thanks, buddy. Jacob says, in essence, photography is a pretty simple process to learn from start to end. The hard part is training the eye, which is a different tool altogether. Completely agree with your 2 Minute Tuesday. Yeah. And I would say, you know, so much of photography is very, very simple to understand. It's really just wrapping your mind around certain concepts. You know, like exposure is just three things, and ISO, shutter speed, and aperture. And when you're shooting film, ISO is already taken care of. Ooh, I almost see. ISO is already taken care of. So you got these two others. You're just working off of aperture and shutter speed. So once you get that figured out, then it's just figuring out how to aesthetically put things in your frame. And then once you get that figured out, then it's what do you actually put in your frame? But I would subject that it's what you actually put in your frame that should be the focus from the get-go. You can get a good exposure of a terrible photo and it's not actually telling a good story, but you can get a slightly off exposure of a great photo and it's still the subject matter makes up for it all. Uneven Toast says, consume less, create more. Yeah, I would agree very much with that. But then I would also say, on the things that you're consuming, broaden the aspect and broaden the horizon of the things that you're consuming. My thing is, if all we're doing is consuming photography, then all we're going to do is reproduce the things that have been produced in the past. But if we start looking at jazz, if we start looking at kickboxing, if we start looking at breakdancing, whatever it might be, you know, just these random things. If you start looking at baseball, if you start looking at whatever it might be, you start to create something through a different set of lenses, apart from the set of lenses that we've been handed through the Americans, that we've been handed through the decisive moment, that we've been handed through, you know, these classics that have been deemed to be like the, you know, the archival masterpieces of photography. So it is create consume less, but at the same time, and the things that you're consuming, be much broader and consume more than just photography. Sean says, from Dorothea Lange, the camera is just an instrument that teaches people to see without a camera. I really do appreciate that and enjoy that. Chris says, I freaking love this answer. I don't know what answer that was, but good. I'm glad. Sean says, so much to that beyond seeing frames and light, but seeing issues and ideas and seeing people. Oh, completely. You know, it's one of those things to where I talked about it a while back, and when I brought the topic up, I feel like the way that the conversation went, especially in the 2 Minute Tuesday live in the comments on the YouTube channel or on the YouTube video, they kind of went in a different direction than what I was anticipating. But I think it was compassion. I'm trying to think of the name of the video, but it was something about compassion. But it was talking about Annie Leibovitz, and there was another photographer that was talking about having compassion for the things that's in front of our lens. It's really about falling in love with the scenes that we're shooting. You know, I talk quite a bit about having a conversation with the things that I'm shooting and being able to converse with even a still inanimate object. You know, having a scene really kind of speak to me and being able to, in a very weird way, you know, this is very weird language to put towards it, but to be able to fall in love with the things that I'm shooting, there's these things to where as soon as it starts to speak to me, I can start to create in a different way than me just composing it to what I think it's supposed to be composed to. And then, you know, it's also in a sense to where if we aren't falling in love with the things that we're shooting, if we aren't having a conversation with the things that we're shooting, then why are we even doing it? And why would we ever expect anyone else to have a conversation with the things that we're shooting? I think oftentimes we think that our photos are supposed to stand on merit alone and on compositional values alone, and that can be the case. There's a lot of my work that is explorations of composition, and the composition becomes part of the narrative. It becomes part of the thing that I'm falling in love with, you know, that I'm trying to share with people. But at the same time, if that's all we ever explore, then why do we expect other people to really be engaged and activated within our photography? It's just a question that I ask myself on occasion. Hello from not so interesting New Jersey. New Jersey is very interesting. Welcome. Leica Nacht says, photography is an art. Oops. Photography is an art that you either have talent or you don't. Yeah, I don't know how I feel about that. I feel like photography is something that can be learned. And I think can be learned by anybody. I think that more importantly is the talent of being able to visually notice and see things in front. I think sometimes we, in like a knock, this isn't a knock on you. This is kind of just my thought process on the whole thing. I think sometimes we try and make photography out to be this grandiose thing that requires much skill and much years of commitment because we want ourselves to feel better. We want to feel like our work is valid and our work is for something and that we're actually investing in something. And I think oftentimes we fall into that trap of going, well, photography is really something that is prestigious. And we fall into that aspect when we're so focused on photography because we've invested year after year after year into diving into the books, into diving into the videos, into diving into all this stuff. And I don't know, I think that probably was the case at one point in time. But now there's iPhones out there. And I'm not going to disregard people creating amazing images with iPhones and not being able to ever get there with a DSLR, not being able to get there on manual. Again, it's not about being able to have the most, you know, amazing gear. It's not being able to have all the understanding about the gear. It's really about creating the things that are being shown at the end of the day. And if that's created with an iPhone on auto compared to a Leica on manual, it makes no difference. It's all about the image. It's all about the story that's being told. It's all about the emotional response that people respond to it on. Yes, there is merit to learning photography. Yes, there is merit to learning gear. And no, the iPhone is never and will never replace a DSLR or replace a Leica or replace any of these other tools. But at the same time, it is a tool and it can still get to an end result that's well worth recognizing and well worth its weight in gold. You know, it's, I don't know. I think sometimes we try and puff ourselves up as photographers and we try and, you know, there's so much of me that, and again, this is not a commentary on anybody out there, even this comment, but I do think that there's often this time to where we get to where we're almost kind of these elitists. And anytime that we get to a place where we're elitist, we've really cut off the life stream of the art form, and we've really severed the tide that's rising and raising everyone else. I'm excited that there's so many people who can actively engage as photographers because it's creating new work that my eyes could come across. It's creating new work that could create emotional responses in me. At the same time, there's a lot of work that just falls flat because everyone is trying to create. But I don't know. I think the moment that we try and, I don't know, I don't want to go off too much more on that tangent. Now is the time to where I have to unplug my headphones and plug into to the power source because my phone is dying. All right, here's the moment in time to where I give the kind of intermission and say, if you've been enjoying this video, go ahead and like. Hit the thumbs up and let YouTube know that you're enjoying this. This will help YouTube to know to push it out into the streams of YouTube after we're all said and done. So go ahead and give a thumbs up. And then also I want to, again, do this every week, but thank you to our guest moderator this week or this month is Anthony from raw_film_photography. It always catches me up. The underscores always get me off. Yeah, go check out Anthony's work. I really do appreciate you. I don't know if today, as I'm scrolling through, it doesn't look like today's too lively in the comments with, trollers. But thank you, Anthony. You're doing a fantastic job, and we always appreciate what it is that that you're doing for us. So let's see here. Going back into some of these topics, Not Afraid of Grain says, I love the Magnum books. They're fantastic. Kit Young says, very interesting topic, Nick. Interestingly, I often take more interesting photographs when I use new gear. There's something about focusing on the task in hand and exploring the unknown. Interesting. I'd be curious to hear a little bit more about that. On my end, I kind of fall in the opposite direction to where when I start using the Kiev 60. I was very focused on trying to use the new camera, but at the same time, it just wasn't translating well as much as something that I'm very familiar with. So that is very interesting. I had some comments that I was going to go into, but I want to kind of try and catch up on some of these. Joe says, hello, Nick, just got in. Did I miss a lot? depends on how far back this comment is. We've gone on a lot of different rants and a lot of different directions, but that's the beautiful thing about YouTube Live now, is they're all cataloged, so you can go back and watch what you missed after the fact. Charlie says, cross-platforming is huge, and how things dissect. I love seeing paintings broken down by the artist or someone who has a grasp of the history of art. Absolutely. Charlie says, Clinton, I use window and door foam weather stripping in the door frame, and it works out great to keep the light leaks out. That's in reference to the darkroom. Emilio, you're from Grand Rapids as well? Welcome. That's awesome. We should grab a coffee at some point. That'd be fantastic. J. Deb says, I have a friend that is a professional copy artist. He said that the hardest art
hardest artist to copy is Mark Rothko. The oldest masters for him were the easiest. Interesting. That's pretty cool. What a interesting profession to have. Professional copy artist. Does that mean he's a scam artist? I just picture that being like a glorified way of saying that he makes fake copies and sells them on the black market for like tons of money. No disrespect to your friend. That's where my mind goes. I just picture some guy in like this shady little apartment selling these, you know, reproductions as real things. Charlie says, Clinton, nice, works well, doesn't it? Got the idea from Matt, nice. Let's see here. I'm going to skip over some of these comments, because... Let's see here. Cristiano Barufaldi? Hi from Italy. Hello. Good seeing you. Clinton says, it is... Okay, you guys are going back and forth. Anthony says, Nick, I saw your PO... V video you recently posted when you were walking around town. What is your thought process? What's making you stop and shoot a photo? It really varies, you know. It's really different on so many different occasions. Sometimes I go out and so yesterday or 2 days ago, actually I think it was both the last 2 days, I went out and I was uninspired by a lot of other things, so I just started searching for more chairs. When in doubt, I shoot chairs, right? And just kind of gave myself the task to go and focus specifically on chairs. So I really kind of went around and just built to that collection of images. But then other times, so when I was walking around with the Kiev the other day, it was really built on composition, and that's why when I did the breakdown photo, I was focused a lot on composition. In the future, I think other breakdown videos will probably go off on a different tangent. I think they'll talk about much more of the soul and the story behind the image, and maybe how they play into other projects that I have going on. Maybe they'll start to talk about how I start to build these projects up, and I think it could go in a lot of different directions. But, you know, for trying to get out there and shoot with a format that I'm very uncomfortable with in shooting in street, is going, okay, I'm gonna start exploring compositional values. And that's why there were a lot of clean compositions, right? A lot of diagonals that fall within a very specific grid, and really kind of getting out there and trying to explore the format as much as, and maybe even a little bit more than exploring the things that were in front of the camera. And that's probably why I was frustrated with a lot of them, is because I was so focused on the format and so focused on the equipment that the images kind of fell flat for me. Even if they worked well compositionally, the subject matter that I was composing just kind of didn't speak to me necessarily. They did in some cases, and if you watch the POV breakdown, I kind of dove through that, but it really kind of depends. I go out there, and as Jay Mazel, I learned this from Jay Mazel, he goes, I try to go out as empty as possible and then allow the day to direct where I'm going. It could be the light of the day. It could be just whatever's happening in town, or whatever is on my mind for the day. I start to think in these terms, and each day is kind of a new subject that I'm kind of approaching. So I don't know. It's not necessarily... A lot of the times it is light and shadow. A lot of the times it is compositional. 9 times out of 10, I'm looking for good light first and foremost, and then I'm going to compose within that, and I'm looking for interesting things within good light. Light is very much a focus of a lot of my work, because I'm consumed by the idea of light. I'm consumed by both in the physical form, but then also in the spiritual form, and how light illuminates things, and how there's just so many different levels that I start to think on, and start to think about how something is emerged from a shadow as soon as it has light on it. And there's a lot of redemptive qualities to it, and a lot of, you know, it's just kind of layers deep. So I'm not just shooting light for light's sake. I'm shooting light because in the long run, I think it's going to build to a larger project to where there is a commentary on light in general. And I think a lot of those bridges are going to be gapped, or gaps are going to be bridged, however you say that. But yeah, so that's a little bit of what it is. And I think the more POV videos that I do, and the more breakdown videos that I do, I think it'll start to kind of allude to a little bit more of how my thought process works on it. Because I think it was Gabe that I was sharing this with, somebody who had commented on the POV video. Maybe it was Jahan. I don't know. Actually, I think it was Jahan. Chances are, in future POV videos and future breakdowns of POVs, I'll probably contradict myself. Because in one scene, I'll be looking for something and critiquing it based off of one set of circumstances and one set of maybe rules. And then in another scene, I'll be breaking it down and critiquing it in a completely different way. Might be much more on, you know, the soul in the subject matter base and the storyline versus the compositional value. But the videos from the other day, or the photos that I took the other day, were very much explorations of composition. So that's what they do get graded on. John Kaomi says, Nick going live while Meek Mill's channel is live too, watching two live streams at the same time. Interesting. Well, good luck. Hopefully you don't get too confused. Cristiano says, we anytime see at first sight in things that our eyes find familiar. Yeah, I do think that we have this certain set of biases. We have this certain set of tropes that we constantly gravitate towards, that we find familiar. And I think part of it is embracing what we find familiar, embracing the things that we've known to be comfortable. But then part of it's pushing ourselves out of the comfort zone, pushing ourselves into the unfamiliar. But I think it's both. I think the thing is, I was kind of thinking about this the other day, the plateaus that I hit in my creative process are either one, when I've focused too much on the familiar, or when I focus too much on the unfamiliar. Because when I focus too much on the unfamiliar and I'm trying to push myself into new areas as much as it's needed, I get to this point to where it's so unfamiliar and so new to me, I just don't know what to do with the results. They're so frustrating that I put myself back in this slump, and I'm creating these peaks and valleys to where as soon as I get into the valley, I start focusing again on the things that I'm familiar with, and it starts to bring me up, and I get to this place to where I start to focus on the unfamiliar, and then I hit this point to where I fall back down. And I think kind of having a balance of both and being able to, that's kind of why I like to balance multiple different projects at once. You know, having 8 different projects going on at one time, 4 of them might be completely experimental, and I might be failing so much throughout those. But, you know, allowing myself to also focus on details and chairs. Chairs is such a comfort zone for me, and I kind of like that. That's why I continue shooting them, because even if all of my other images are failing, I at least know that I can make a good composition out of a chair. And that sounds silly, but at the same time, it kind of keeps me at an even keel and at least moving up a hill gradually in my mind. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. Clinton says, when I started photography, they gave me a plastic camera. His philosophy was that a good photograph is less about technical aspects and perfection and more about subject and composition. That's amazing. And I think if more people started off with a Holga or with a point and shoot, they'd probably gravitate, or they'd probably advance in their photography and advance in the storylines of their photography much quicker. I do think that the first 10%, you know, the first things that we should focus on within photography might be composition and learning to tell a story well. I think sending people out with an iPhone or with a point and shoot is probably much more beneficial than trying to get them to wrap their mind around aperture and shutter speed. Just my thoughts. Clinton, thank you for sharing that. Jacob says, completely agree. That's a large portion of why I love Diane Arbus' book so much. Technically, she has underexposed and out-of-focus photos, but they speak to the soul despite this. Yeah, Diane Arbus is huge on that. Same with Sally Mann. So much of their works are really kind of challenging the concepts of, look at Daido Moriyama as well. I mean, to kind of go to an extreme other end of the spectrum. I don't know if I have any of his books on hand, but his works just go extremely grainy and blurry, and they're like woodblock prints. And it's so far out of the realms of technical perfection, but at the same time, they capture a soul. They capture a certain something that offers more than just technical perfection. And I think understanding that first and foremost, and then adding the technicals to it afterwards is a good thing. But yeah, Diane Arbus, Sally Mann, Daido Moriyama, even Gary Winogrand, looking at his works, he really embraced imperfection. He really embraced, you know, Dutch angles was such a staple of his works, but it's not to a terrible Dutch angle sense. He was breaking rules of composition, and in a lot of ways, he knew how to do the rules of composition, but he really didn't care about them. It was much more about capturing life. So many people describe Gary Winogrand's work as a dance. They say if you look in there, there's just so much dancing going on in his work. And he's not shooting dancers. He's shooting just life. But it is kind of this dance that happens in front of the lens. Charlie says, got to get back to work. Have a good one, everyone. See you, buddy. Jacob, talking about Diane Arbus, says her street photos have startling observations of her subjects that examine their characters completely. Clinton says, I love her work, Jacob. She would often repeat, probably your art professor that you're talking about, he would often repeat that in order to take a good photograph, you should know what a good photograph is. We didn't even dive into the triangle, exposure triangle is what I'm assuming you're talking about, until the second semester. Nice. That is important. I think much more of photography is learned by studying successful photographs and successful stories told with photographs than it is about studying the owner's manual of our cameras. All that stuff can kind of be fumbled through, but it's really having an image that tells a story at the end of the day. Mike says, I've watched several of your videos and never noticed that frame on the ceiling. need to know. It better be a frame and not an attic door. Yeah, that's actually our most famous art piece right up there. So we put it on the ceiling so that way, you know, it just has this lofty weight above everything else. No, it's the attic. Let's see here. Oops. Hold on, I gotta scroll back up. Sometimes it jumps down. Okay, here we go. Pete Donovan says, yeah, I kind of am wondering about the frame on the ceiling as well. It's funny. It's the attic. J-Dub, my six-year-old granddaughter takes amazing images from her Instax. She sees the world in a different way. Kids, I think, are some of the greatest photographers because they don't, you know, maybe their images aren't the best composed. Maybe not even composed at all. But at the same time, you feel the excitement that they had. Oftentimes, I mean, my niece, I give her a camera and she's running around and they're just blurry images, but it's like the excitement that she has for the scene in front of her. Like she just puts her all into capturing the things and she's just amazed by everything. Whether or not it builds to a good story at the end of the day, that's another thing. But at the same time, I would almost argue that it does because she has an excitement about things in front of her and she's not consumed by the camera in her hand. She's just excited to have a camera in her hand to give weight to the things that she's seeing. So I like that. Sean says, gotta run. Thanks for the chat. I enjoy this type of maybe higher-minded discussion in photography. Yeah, I completely agree. And see you, buddy. Loose Luck Rabatail. Hey, Nick. Hey. Cristiano says, it's about the message, not about the gear. Yes. Saxon says, hey, Nick, just got caught up on the live stream. Hope I didn't miss it like last week. Yeah, we got plenty to go, so we're at 6 o'clock. Probably go for another half an hour. So you didn't miss much? I mean, you did miss a bunch, but you could watch it in the replay. It was timed out. I just seen this. It says Negro was timed out. It just sounds like you put him in timeout, Anthony. That's funny. J-Dub, LOL, no, he doesn't have it for galleries and science. Heat waves. Do you still push film but develop at box speed for contrast? Read about it on your blog. I'd have to go back and read what... No, I think as far as pushing... Oh, I'm starting to get hit by... I'm going to move that over. There we go. As far as pushing, if I remember correctly, I've always kind of pushed the same way, but I overexpose by a stop, and then I develop at the speed that I'm pushing to. So 1600, I'm exposing at 800 and then developing for 1600, which overexposes the negative. I get nice thick negatives, but at the same time, there's still plenty of contrast to work in. Emilio says, yeah, I'm really pumped for this summer in the Mexican Festival and Art Prize in GR. I'm planning a portrait project in Zine. That's fantastic. Nice. Emilio, are you putting anything in Art Prize? I'm curious. I was talking to Emily the other day on whether or not I'll do it again this year. I think I might. I sold my piece from last year, which was a great little commission coming in. So it'd be nice to be able to do the same and just get that extra exposure. John Roberts, what's up, buddy? Good seeing you out there. Saxon says, I really enjoyed your POV and the follow-up breakdown video a lot. Thank you so much. Jacob's got a bounce. We'll watch the remaining live stream later. See you, buddy. But yeah, the follow-up video for the POV, I know it was a little bit long, but at the same time, I don't want to skimp on trying to share some of the thought process that I have on those. So hopefully you guys are able to put those in the background while you're scanning film or anything. And not that my thought process is anything to be written home about as far as photography, but at the same time, I do get questions on this stuff quite a bit, and I want to be as transparent as possible to either one, help validate and affirm some of the ways that you think about your work, or two, help cement and plant you into the ways that you think about your work if it's different than the ways that I think about my work. Sometimes it's better to disagree heavily with someone on something to really realize where you're standing in that point. But yeah, so I just want to put all my thoughts out there and not really center myself too much on trying to shorten it all down. Clinton, it was good seeing you, buddy. Thanks for the exchange of ideas. I love these sessions. Me too. Thanks for joining in. Chairs, comfort. I didn't even think about that. As long as they're comfy chairs. Saxon says, I personally find it easier to compose with an SLR compared to a point-and-shoot. Interesting. I enjoy shooting at the point-and-shoot, and actually this time I have... this is my favorite point and shoot. It's the Minolta AFSV, and actually I'm gonna grab a shot here, but I really enjoy shooting with this. It's kind of like a rangefinder, to where I pull it up to my eye and I just get the frame lines, and yeah, I don't know. I was the same way, to where I really, really enjoyed SLRs until I started shooting heavily with the rangefinder, and then just having the disconnected patch for the lens just started translating much better for me. So, but then again, I know a lot of people who are much more on this side of SLR going, I just can't look through a rangefinder. It's so weird to not be able to see what it is what you get, kind of thing, or what you see is what you get. Daniel says, a lot, a photographer is like a painter. We paint with oil or with light. Using gear or brushes, we see and build the image. But most importantly, we communicate a story, motion, poetry, or just beauty. I completely agree. And actually, that'll bring me down to Jahan's comment earlier on the YouTube video. I'll read this. He says, photography is just the medium for your emotional and metaphysical mental expression. People focus on photography, in parentheses, the skill of gear, because it's connected to materialism. A great camera, a special film, a modern and larger, fine grain, because things like this can be bought. This happens less in the classic arts because, if then, in an incredibly small degree, artists don't ramble on about what kind of paintbrush they are using and the canvas that they, and if their canvas can do this or that. The greatest photography has always been about expressionism and storytelling, and that's something a lot of photographers underestimate, highly in my opinion, he says. You're creating a story, a set of events, and reacting to something through your own interpretation of the scene or happenings. This is why it's important to see before you shoot, because you shouldn't rely on what your camera sees, but what your eye sees. Your view should be implemented into what your camera reproduces. I completely agree. And I would actually add on to that or even say something like that in a different way of oftentimes when we get so caught up on the gear, we think through the lens of the gear, and actually we should be, the lens of the gear should be subject to our creative vision, not the other way around. And obviously there is limitations to some lenses. You're not going to get the kind of compression that you might out of a 90 from a 35. Obviously there's these ways that we have to think through our gear, but at the same time we should be choosing our gear based off of our visual interests and the things that we see, you know. So Daniel, I completely agree. Absolutely love your comment. Jahan, if you're out there, I love your comment. I think that those are perfectly paired together. Uneven Toast says, do you ever have happy accidents happen? I've taken images and don't remember some of the details that I've captured or good points I've captured. Not sure if it's my subconscious or a happy accident. Yeah, completely. There's actually, I don't have any of the photos around, but there's an image that I did that's actually on color. I think it was on my Canon 8E1, and I shot a building. I was looking up at the building, and then I accidentally opened the back and light leaked the film, but I still had it developed. And there, this building was split in half. One half has standard colors, and it was a kind of a blue sky day, and then the other half has these oranges that just stand out and just contrast the other side so well, and it was just this super happy accident. And then there's the image of the face. So just one or two, no, I think it was three posts back on my Instagram was a post of the face. It was looking through a window at a bar called the Bob here in town. We were at the opening reception for Art Prize, the big gallery open, or the big art competition that happens here in town. And this last year we were at this opening, and I shot this photo. Something drew me to it in the first place, and I can't remember, to be honest with you, if I seen the face in the first place or not. I don't know if I'm that intelligent to be able to perceive something like that, but in looking at the image, it's undoubtedly a face. And then the arch of the door really finishes off the back of the face, and whether it was intentional or not, I really don't know, but at the same time, I'm going to embrace it, and I shot it, so I can claim it. And I do enjoy stuff like that. There are times where there are happy accidents. There's times where I'll be shooting street photography and I'll be focused on something that's happening in the foreground and then missing what's happening in the background, but the two play off of each other so well. And I'm trying to train my eye to be able to look layers deep at all times, but sometimes you just miss it. But then sometimes when you miss it, you've actually found it. It's very profound. That was a happy accident too. So anyways, thanks buddy for asking that. Anthony says, I viewed this TMT as the same as cooking, culinary background, sorry. But you learn to cook, and that knowledge is the tool you use to give someone experience through their taste buds. I like that. I like that a lot. Let's see here. Emilio, I probably won't be submitting anything into Art Prize. Sort of still trying to find my own artistic ground, if that makes sense. That does make sense. I would challenge you, Emilio, and I'd say, you know, like, even if you're not established within your artistic, you know, vision and voice, it's still a great place to really start to experiment and share out, you know, and start to put some test things out. Sometimes we think that exhibitions or competitions need to be a place where we only exhibit our best works or works that we know are firm and established. But sometimes it could be a great place to just use it as a creative playground too and share something that you might be wrestling with just to see what the conversation it has with the viewers might be. So that's a great place to put it up because you're not going to find a whole lot of criticism from a lot of people. You could actually get some interesting responses from people to see if you watch them and how they approach and see. So J-Dub says, happy accident with almost every role. Mostly bummers, though. Well, then that's an unhappy accident, right? J-Dub says, hey, Nick, have you talked to Matt Day about his experience with composing in the square format? He has good insight, in my honest opinion. Yeah, actually, I haven't talked to him too much about square. At the same time, Matt shoots family in square, and I find it much easier to shoot family in square. Some of my all-time favorite photos of my nieces, of my godson, are shot in square format. And I can think in that type of terminology and in that type of format. It's just, I guess, when I go out to street. So I'll have to look at some of his street work and see how much of it is in square. But then again, at the same time, I'm really just over trying to shoot in square format for street photography. Why isn't this charging? Hold on, guys. Apparently my phone has been plugged in, but it hasn't been charging. Plugged in here. I don't know what's going on, so hopefully it doesn't die on me. And actually, we got about 10 minutes left, so let's see here. Mike R. says, do you dabble much with instant photography? Recently got back into SX70, the new Polaroid Originals black and white. Find I'm carrying it regularly with my film cameras for the instant gratification. Yeah, actually, I really do enjoy. I'm looking to see. I don't know where I put them. Give me one second. Now that I'm tethered, I could actually go back and grab something. Hopefully I didn't moon you guys there. But I had these little... whoa, what's going on here? Stop it. My computer is possessed. It's like... Okay, hold on. Sorry, guys. My computer just started scrolling. Oh, it's because I'm hitting the down button. Okay, that makes more sense. Let me stop this. Let me get back to the comments. All right. Anyways, I do really enjoy Polaroid stuff, and actually there's a few works in it. When I had FP100C, I was doing these transfers to where I would shoot the image, then I would take the negative immediately and start rollering it onto this paper, and you start to get these portraits that were just really unique. And I wanted to do more of this stuff, but then they discontinued 100C, and instead of trying to shoot it and get re-excited about it, I actually just sold it all off and made a decent profit when everyone was freaking out about it. But I have a lot of just different things that I do enjoy shooting instant film. And in one of these, I don't know if it's this one, there's a lot more Instax. Let's see here. No, I don't know which one of these. I have a few of these different books, but I do have an Instax wide 310 or 210 that someone's sending more film for that I look forward to shooting, and I do want to do a bit of a instant film project, maybe a specific zine with it. But it's just so expensive that I don't shoot much of it. Although I'm very, very happy that Polaroid Originals film came down in price. So I do want to get some of the SX70 film, because I have that one step, like the one that they originally designed the Instagram, the first Instagram logo off of. I have that, and it shoots SX70 film. So I would like to do some of that with the, especially Polaroid Originals black and white. That'd be amazing. Tadius. Says, talking about square format, oddly enough, I like to shoot landscapes and cityscapes with my 6x6. Nice. See, I can see that. I really, really love Michael Kenna's work with 6x6, so I could see going out and doing landscape photography. And especially, I find that, I guess this is probably the thing. When I have a simplistic subject matter, when I'm honing in, this is probably why I really enjoyed the letters casting the shadows in the POV video, that single shot, or even the first one, even though I'd like to crop it down, that first one I still found appealing, because, you know, when you strip away a lot of things and you just work with this minimalistic, I find that square format works minimalistic so, so well, and it's so powerful when it's minimalized. So I could see going out and doing cityscapes or landscapes and doing very, very simple, minimal compositions with that kind of thing. Daniel says, I have to leave. It's late here, and tomorrow I'll be exposing at a collective art exhibition in Jerusalem. Thanks again for your inspiration. That's awesome, man. And thanks for joining in. It's good seeing you. We'll see you next time. J-Dab took a macro of a flower, and there was a six-eyed spider on the edge of the petal. Never seen it. It was in perfect focus. That's amazing. I'd like to see that shot. Let's see here. Saxon says, do you think you'd have a better time shooting 6x7 for street? No, 6x7 is another one of those things to where it works well for portraiture for me, but it doesn't work well for my standard. Like, I don't like shooting 6x7 for my personal work in a lot of different ways. It's still too smushed. I just like the 2x3 ratio, that 1.5 rate, like the 1.5 like golden ratio. I don't know, that's how my vision it works. I like to work in the vertical format. I like to work in very tall vertical formats, not necessarily very, very tall, but in the 2x3 vertical format. So most of my work, I can't see in 6x7, because as soon as I go vertical with 6x7, it's just too short. I don't know. I've had a bunch of 6x7s. I had a RB67, two RZ67s, a Pentax 67. Enjoyed all of those. Enjoyed them for landscapes. Enjoyed them for portraiture. But anytime I go to street photography, or you know, my personal work, the details work, it's all in 2x3. I don't like cropping down to the 5x7 ratio. That's why I switched over to matting, you know, quote unquote matting all the images when I post them up on Instagram, is giving them that extra bit of space to be able to go tall, given that surrounding. Because when it cropped down to that 5x7, I just lost a lot of the detail that I worked so intentionally to put into the photo. So, hi from Singapore. Hello, Ezekiel. Good seeing you in here. John says, I think 6x7 format is the format I relate to the most. Nice. 6x7 is very, very similar to a 4x5 ratio. And again, it's one of those things to where when I take the 4x5 out, there's very specific things that I see when I'm shooting 4x5. But I wouldn't go running around with the 4x5 and shooting a lot of the different things that I'm shooting when I'm shooting the Leica. It's two completely different visions for me. Tadia says, then again, I borrowed a panoramic camera that exposed 24 by 55 negatives, negative of 35 millimeter, and it was the stuff for the landscapes for me. Complemented with 6x6, I can imagine a project with it. Yes. See, and that's another one to where, like I said, I like working in the wide format. The only camera that I still kind of drool over when I look at, you know, eBay or anything like that, and then, you know, I immediately, as soon as I see the price, I just forget and kill those dreams, is the Hasselblad X-Pan, right? Getting that super pano frame. For street photography in particular, being able to shoot pano, being able to get that extra width, starts to bring it into a more cinematic aspect, and you start to get like almost the letterbox type feel. And I really like how street photography translates, especially when you're building a story all the way throughout. So I would really, even if it's just to borrow a X-Pan for a little bit, I would really enjoy that, I believe. Finzi says, taking an RB and RZ into the street, that's a tough one. Yeah, it is. I use a monopod when I go out there with the RB back in the day, and people would just look at me so weird because you just look like Gandalf running around the city, like saying, you shall not pass. You kind of look like, I actually had some people that kind of crossed over to the other side of the road because it's kind of looks like a bludgeon weapon. I don't know, it's just so crazy. But I have friends that kind of strap them around their neck and kind of run and gun with that, with an RB or RZ, and it's just far too much for me. My back is already hurting me, so to try and carry that thing around would just be ridiculous. J-Dub says, I like 35 and 645. The Fuji Hasi X-Plan is crazy. Yes. And 645 is another one that I do feel like 645 is that balance between, you know, the 5x7 you know, 6x7, 4x5 to the 35mm. It's kind of the in-between. And I do really enjoy, I have the Mamiya 645 back here that I shoot on every wedding that we do, all the portraiture shots that I do on that. It's such an amazing, amazing format. Sometimes with portraits, the 35mm frame lens when doing vertical is a little bit too tall. So I do find that the 645 is like the absolute perfect ratio for me when I'm doing vertical portraiture. I really like working within the means of that. Ezekiel says, thank you for the shout out, bro. I love my Hasselblad 500cm. Black and white is so beautiful. Yes. And I will say the Hasselblad is an amazing, amazing piece of kit. The lenses that you could get for that are just unreal. There's something different to looking through a Hasselblad than looking through so many other square format cameras. Like I said, I had a Bronica SQ. I have this Kiev 60. I had the Yashica 124. I've shot Rollies. But looking down through or looking through the prism finder of a Hasselblad, it's a completely different experience. I don't know what it is about it, but it has just something to it. I ordered a 3D printed 35mm adapter for my medium format camera. Excited to try it out. That is one thing that I wanted to try out on the 6.7, but never got around to it, is getting the 35mm adapter and shooting, because you're essentially shooting the like X-pan wide format in that. Because the 6x7 goes so wide, and then you're cropping essentially the 6x7 down to a, you know, 35mm frame. That'd be pretty fun. And then I even thought about like making a printout, like a on clear, whatever printer material, and printing the frame lines. So that way I knew where my film ended, and I could compose properly. But I never got around to it. You should do this. You shall not pass thing. I felt like it. It definitely felt like it. Funzie says, speaking of which, have you considered a 6x9 camera? No, it is the 2x3 ratio, but with the huge negatives. One, my scanner for medium format sucks. I have this old Epson 3170, and even scanning the shots for the point of view from the Kiev 60, I don't like the quality of scans that I get from it. So I've just lost a lot of my luster for medium format as far as personal work. I still love 35mm. I'm not really one for, you know, all the detail in the world. I think 35mm negatives give me plenty of detail to work with. At the same time, I'd like to shoot maybe a roll or two, but I'd probably send it off to the lab, and that starts to get pretty pricey. So it'd be something to play with, maybe to do a specific small project on, but not something that I'd work into a daily process or anything. Saxon says, been thinking about doing a street session with my Yashica Flex B. Haven't run a roll through it yet, so hopefully it works. Nice. That'll be fun. The Yashica Flex. Is that the same as like the... Is that a different? I guess I'd never heard of the Yashica Flex. J Deb says, I occasionally use my Fuji 645Zi. It's a 645 point and shoot. It's relatively small and light. It's great for landscapes. Image quality is very nice. That's really cool. Yeah, when we did our artist residency out in Maine, I shot quite a bit with the 645 Mamiya. I actually really want to get my hands on a 55mm lens for it, because I borrowed one from the camera shop. And I really, really enjoyed shooting landscapes with the 645 format on the 55mm lens. So I would almost see using something like the 645 Fuji, the more point-and-shoot, or even the rangefinder one, on like a trip out on the coastal side or anything like that. That'd be a lot of fun. All right, I'm gonna give this maybe a couple more minutes before I jump off, and actually my battery's probably gonna die here soon. So real quick, a couple things. Go ahead and like the video down below, give it a thumbs up. I cover this a couple times throughout these live streams, but that's gonna show YouTube that you're enjoying the content, and it'll help push it out there. And then two, after this video, I want to give kind of a call to action right now, is after this video, when the video gets posted up as an actual video on the channel, I'd love for you to go and share in the video comments one or two things that you took away from this, or one or two things that you weren't able to share within this conversation. So the more that we can get conversations rolling on this, the more that YouTube will recognize this conversation and put it out there in front of others, to where others can grow and learn from these in-depth conversations with us as well. And then it will also get the conversation rolling in there, to where we can continue the conversation on even after the live stream. So I'm going to finish up with a couple of these comments, but also, as of right now, I'd love for you guys to start posting your Instagram's handles, so that way you could start connecting with each other over on Instagram, and we could really take this community cross-platform. So let's see here. Ezekiel says, sometimes just a bit crazy with a left and right. Give me your address and I'll send you a 35 millimeter adapter, bro. Thanks so much. Yeah, the address is actually in all of my videos, so it's a PO box. But yeah, if you look in the channel description or in any of the previous videos, it's in the description of any of those. So I appreciate that. Thank you. Pete says, gotta go. I have about 20 inches of snow to shovel. Oh man, enjoy. See you, buddy. J-Dab, Nick, any tips on keeping Tri-X and Acros flat? My film is fresh. It cups a little. Yeah, Fuji Acros and Tri-X are both known, especially within Michigan. Our water content really works well to curl Tri-X and stuff. One of the big things is I highly suggest, when you get it done, because there's not a whole lot, you can kind of run a shower. You could try running a shower just before to put some moisture in the air, and it sounds kind of counterproductive. Why would you want to put moisture in the air when you're wanting your film to dry? But get some moisture in the air. Run a hot shower, and then hang your film to dry. That's going to do two things, actually, for you. One, it's going to take all the dust down to the floor, so you don't have any dust on your negatives. But then two, it will keep the negatives moist enough as they're drying to kind of give it a gradual drying and not curl so much. But then two, grab one of these and fold it back on itself. So roll it back on itself against the curl and put it in one of these overnight. And, you know, typically a night, maybe two nights, you'll pull them out and they'll be nice and flat for you. They'll have a nice flat base where you can scan them properly and all that kind of stuff. So there's two different ideas for you to try. Saxon says, it's a TLR that was made before the Yashica mats. Got it for $18 at a garage sale. Nice, that's a good deal. Kevin Benedict, would you give me some feedback on one of my Instagram photos? Kevin Ben, I don't want likes. I just want to know which photo you pick and what you would say about it. I know everyone wants that, but nice. Kevin, if you send a photo over specifically that you're looking for a critique on, send it over to my Instagram at Nick Exposed. Just shoot me a DM with that photo in it. I'd love to give you a critique. Let me know exactly what it is that you're trying to accomplish with the photo, and I'll let you know if it seems to accomplish what it is that you want out to accomplish well or not. Ezekiel Kokeep, let's connect. Awesome. Thank you guys. I think we're gonna cut it off here. I'll give a couple minutes to really just kind of share your Instagram handles out there, but I really do appreciate you guys. We didn't get through all of the comments that I wanted to feature from the channel, but we had amazing conversation going on in the live stream. So I really wanted to just focus on what it was that you guys were working through as well. So Ezekiel says, thanks, Nick. God bless. Thanks, buddy. I appreciate you. If you guys want to continue this conversation, like I said, when the video goes up, jump over and leave it in the comments. And actually, I think as soon as the